Are there more questions? Yes, please, over there, yes. Yes, please.
My name is Þórólfur Matthíasson. I'm a professor of economics at the University of Iceland. We met briefly in Athens in March 2013. At a restaurant below the Acropolis. And I would like to ask you, even you, if you asked not to get questions regarding Greece, but would you please tell us a bit why were there success in Iceland and not in Greece? What was the difference? And I am not asking about the specialities, but on a general difference between those two countries and the two programs. Thank you.
Let me start with the... one day I'm going to have a meeting without being asked about Greece, but this is obviously somewhere down the road. I think it's almost meaningless to compare the two cases because they are so fundamentally different as far as the nature of the problem is concerned. In Iceland's problem was dramatic, but as I said, the Iceland business model was fine. I mean, the Iceland economic, real sector was dynamic, and we knew that it had a history of significant labor market flexibility, and this is why we could focus the conditionality very narrowly. Iceland had fiscal space, as I said. It had a history of sound fiscal policies. In the contrary, in that sense, the Greek challenge was much more complex. And that is, this was a case where the fiscal deficit had been allowed to increase by 12-13% of GDP since euro adoption because of easy money associated with the common currency, which meant that, in a sense, there was an easing of financial condition, interest rate come down, and that windfall associated with the euro adoption had essentially been spent to increase pensions and social transfers by 8-9% of GDP. So here you have a country that suddenly wake up with a big fiscal problem. Because of higher nominal pension and transfers in a country that is in a fixed currency area that cannot inflate relative to the rest of Europe, that has low inflation because of its members of the Eurozone. That was an extremely complex and painful process of correcting that fiscal problem. And it had clearly problems on productivity, and there were clearly issues with labor market flexibility and other issues that we not had in Iceland. In that sense, it was also much more complicated. Now, one thing that they did not have in Greece, the Greek banking system was not part of the original problem. It was not. The Greek banking system was a victim of the crisis. So I don't think that it's very... very meaningful to compare the two, but let me just give you one set of figures. In both cases, I said we estimated that Iceland debt to GDP would peak at 109% of GDP because of the crisis. In Greece, it started out with debt about the same level, perhaps 10 percentage point higher. But because they were in a currency union, with no ability to inflate relative to the center, we knew they could not depreciate. They had to go through a brutal process of internal devaluation. So even when we sent a program to the board, we knew that debt to GDP, ex ante, we had in our projection that debt to GDP would go from about 115% of GDP to 155, 160% of GDP. And it then, because the program underperformed in several years, it went even higher. But we knew that Greece would go through a brutal process of internal devaluation that would be politically difficult and it would spook market. Here, of course, you have an independent monetary policy. And debt to GDP went the other way fast. So I don't think one can fairly compare the two cases. Greece still face a complex situation, but Greece have undertaken tremendous fiscal adjustment fiscal adjustment on a scale that few other countries have done. But as I said, its problems were also to start with more complex.